Delighted that you could join us this evening. In the description, it says, can films that depict urgent social problems challenge viewers to change their views? Does cinema more than photography run the risk of aestheticizing the suffering of people, ecosystems, and other living things? Dr. Anil Narine, he's the editor of the book Ecotrauma Cinema with Rutledge. And he has taught cinema studies and communication in the Department of Visual Studies and the Institute of Communication, Culture, Information, and Technology at the University of Toronto since 2010. He returns to SFU where he studies in the School of Communication, where he studied in the School of Communication, and now teaches in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology. He's been a visiting research student in the School of History, Art and Film at Birkbeck College, University of London, and in 2011-12, he was a postdoctoral fellow in film at Columbia University. His research examines social networks, global inequalities, and sites of human and ecological trauma in the context of globalization and thickening global connections. So I ask you to join me in welcoming Anil Narine.
Thank you. This one going here. This is a very august forum to have, and I don't think I deserve it. So I'll endeavor to earn it, because this is really great and sort of self-indulgent for me to be able to speak and to speak to a nice group of people who are going to listen to some of my ideas. And then hopefully you can really challenge me afterwards, if you disagree with anything, that'll be great for the purposes of the discussion. So I've been looking at this, what I call cinema of environmental crisis, for a number of years. And it arose because I'd actually just sort of accidentally, I think, seen a number of these films in a row around maybe 2010. And I was really enamored with them, and I found myself thinking about them over and over. I'd seen Grizzly Man, you can see there the poster, Darwin's Nightmare, about the introduction of a really nasty species of fish by the British into Lake Victoria, Africa. I'd seen these films about nature, and I thought, something's going on here. They're being made in great numbers, and at that time, with The Cove, they were winning the awards as well. They were very prominent. And a lot of it sort of followed on the heels of Al Gore's big film, The Inconvenient Truth, and Inconvenient Truth in 2006. So it sort of came out of something that I wasn't even researching, and then became something to look at. And I've already heard from some people that a lot of folks, or some folks in here, have seen a great deal of these films. So they circulate. So the question is, what is eco-cinema? How can we delimit it or map what that is? And then once we've done that, how can you analyze what it tells us? So that's part of the project that any scholar in communication has, which is what my training was. And then, of course, the final question, so what? That's always an important one, I think. And we can question, what is this form? Is there a form there to study? Why does it span all these different genres, like documentary, fiction film, these disaster fantasy films, apocalyptic films such as Mad Max and so on? And then what are these images telling us, and how can we make sense of some of those things, or at least ask the right questions about these images? So I reached out to colleagues with a call for papers. I'd never done this before. I didn't really know what I was doing. I was extremely junior, and I got inundated with a lot of emails. I put a posting out that said, what is eco-trauma cinema? Can we call it that? I looked at these films and said, there's something ecological going on, but there's also something about sites of trauma, whether they're ecological or whether it's trauma to the human, in terms of a natural disaster, or in terms of, in some cases, we'll look at turning to nature for healing purposes. So there was a whole web of connections between ecology and trauma that I wanted to figure out. And I got all these responses. And some of the people said, I want to participate. And they were senior scholars with big names. And then I got really nervous, and I didn't know what to do. And I said, well, I guess we have to move ahead with the thing because I can't let these people down. So you can see some of the examples of the papers that came in, and these are the ones that ended up being published. Scholar there, Barbara Creed, who wrote The Monstrous Feminine more than 20 years ago. Australian scholar looked at A Zed in Two Knots by Peter Greenaway and Darwin's Nightmare. Charlie Muster looked at documentary history. Al Siegert looked at Grizzly Man. And on and on. It was so interesting. Swan Su, a colleague from California, looked at the Korean film The Host, if anyone's seen that, about a big nasty monster that's created from the toxins in the Han River in Seoul, Korea. It's very much about pollution and development and neoliberal policies in Korea. So it's a monster film with all sorts of depth. So it was wide-ranging, and the scope was pretty global, and I was glad to have papers about Asian cinema, Belgian cinema, two films about the Asian tsunami in 2004. So, right, I don't really love to make lists and categories too much, but as an academic, I find myself doing it. We like to do that. It's part of our DNA, I think, to do this. So, you know, looking at these films, I sort of started to break it down. Well, there's activist documentaries, clearly, Blackfish and The Cove and so on, against the captivity industry of cetaceans and of whales. But we started to see other trends as well. Nature as a healer became a big theme that was hard to ignore, whether it's Dead Calm, where Nicole Kidman loses a child and ends up taking a yacht trip with Sam Neill to try to get over that, or Babel, where they've also lost a child. That's a big theme, actually. It comes up time and again, so we decided to sort of name it. Why Look at Animals, number three, comes from the John Berger analysis. So John Berger, the art historian, author of Ways of Seeing, wrote this analysis, Why Do We Look at Animals? And he comes up with some interesting points about that. And of course, Nature's Revenge, probably the most common or the most exciting form in this cinema. And I came across all sorts of cinephile blogs and websites doing the research where they called these eco-horror and other things, where people get lost in the woods and all sorts of bad stuff happens. So some examples of these things, so Inconvenient Truth, you know, as a really classic activist documentary, The Cove about dolphins, Food Inc. about our food system, Nature as a Healer, of course, Dead Calm, we mentioned there, Babel, Vignette about the Asian tsunami, Antichrist even, the Lars von Trier film, the couple has lost a child and goes to this cabin in the woods. So it's incredible how many of the same stories we tell over and over again, as if they haven't been told before. But they are they're retold in different ways and with different, I guess, in different terms. And the animal films, Grizzly Man was a big one. Rogue is about going crocodile viewing in Australia and the Northern Territory. So looking at animals as a commodified experience. Blackfish, of course, is about looking at killer whales as a commodified experience. And of course, SeaWorld is under a lot of pressure right now. So is the Vancouver Aquarium. So these are films that continue to be produced and concerns that continue to be sort of heightened. And revenge films. So Deliverance, about the four men who go into the woods, who go on the canoe trip. Jaws, of course. And Blackwater, again, another Australian film about crocodiles, about people engaging in sort of a tourism and getting a very bad result. So an important question when anyone is choosing a medium to look at for an academic analysis or any analysis is why that medium and why not television or fiction or some other medium. And so I decided on cinema because I was consuming a lot of it and trying to make sense of it. And I found that essentially these sorts of films, these four types, fit into these categories here. People that get traumatized by the natural world, people that do damage to the natural world or its species, and of course the sort of a post-apocalyptic story that's so common and that was so huge this summer with Mad Max and continues to be on television and so on. We somehow like to see this sort of imagery. So a lot of our discussions putting the project together revolves around how are we going to separate documentary from fiction cinema, narrative cinema, or are we going to look at these things together? And we decided to try to get rid of this opposition entirely because we found that the feature films, the fiction films, were engaging questions that are very real, even though they do it in a different form that might be almost fantastical or conjured in some way. But the actual material they're engaging is very real and can invoke our very real concerns. So we have this sort of classic, you know, disparaging view of fiction cinema that's out there that goes back to the beginning of film studies. But in fact, we argue that fiction and fantasy, these films that we look at, even Lord of the Rings and so on, has an incredible ecological component to it, to that series. So just because it takes the form of, say, fantasy or fiction or is conjured in some way through computer effects doesn't mean it's not addressing the real in terms of the real concerns of our time and real pressing, unsettling issues. So even though it's fiction, one term here is that it can provide a cognitive map of ways to engage with real problems. So the fiction can be a path into ways to think about actual concerns. So this is an actual image of the Asian tsunami in 2004, the devastating event that claimed hundreds of thousands of lives. And images like this are upsetting, and they provoke a lot of responses and get us, I think, properly upset in some cases about these sorts of events in terms of a humanitarian crisis and ways that Westerners far away from there can respond. And then Hollywood comes along, or in this case, I guess it was sort of a, this is the impossible, an international co-production. Spain was heavily involved in producing this film. And years after the fact can produce imagery that gives us some other sense of what that experience is like. So yes, it's a camera crew, it's full of digital effects and so on. It's not claiming to be a documentary at all, but it situates the viewer in certain ways that really can be done only through this sort of production. So we'll have a peek here at the most famous scene, of course, from the film. So how do we make sense of imagery like that when we're talking about a fiction film? There's the old saying that art is a lie that tells the truth. And I think there's something about the incredible painstaking work that goes into conjuring this imagery that has this incredible ability to situate us sort of in that space. We can see the pictures and the documentary footage from above, which there is, and tourists took photos and video of their experiences with the tsunami. But here in The Impossible, we get this, really a child's view of the experience. They're using sound, of course, to signify being underwater and being knocked almost unconscious and so on. I mean, this is traumatic stuff. But it does some sort of work on us psychologically. So, and in this case, we could say possibly it helps to provide some sort of map of the scale of that experience for those people, and to let those of us far away from there sort of access that experience, even though it's fiction that provides a way in. Well, we could say it's a fictional narrative film that is about a real event. But of course, they're recreating all of this stuff with computers and with a massive set. So we didn't want to make the old mistake of disparaging a certain form of cinema and privileging another form. Yes, definitely. Hollywood can and does reduce complex events to simple events. It offers Hollywood endings. In fact, The Impossible is incredible technically, but is, at a narrative level, very problematic because it focuses entirely on a white Western family that's vacationing in Thailand and their struggles through the emergency relief system and being separated into certain tents and so on, and of course provides a Hollywood ending. Not to spoil it, but it has, of course, Ewan McGregor and Naomi Watts who reunite at the end. So yes, fiction film is also very guilty of many things, but looking past that is kind of the fun part and the more difficult part. As a map, it can help us overcome disavowal, saying, well, that's far away, that's difficult for me to understand. It can help us think about how we're implicated in certain ecological harm. Of course, this is a natural disaster. It's nothing to do with any human activity. And it can provide this sort of map to help us think through other questions. So it can be a sort of way in. And you know, one thing that people always cite in this debate is Silent Spring. So Rachel Carson's book from 1962 is really seen now as a founding text of the environmental movement in North America. And it was a speculative fiction book that talked about a spring with no insects, a spring that was silent from all the toxins that were being used on crops at the time. So she also used fiction as a way to communicate with people emotionally, to put it in moral terms about pesticides, and to speculate on a future that might be awaiting people if things went along the way they were going. So fiction actually plays an interesting role in framing real-life concerns and debates. And this is now seen as this absolutely founding text. And when we think about science fiction, we don't question it so much. We love science fiction, many of us, because you know, Blade Runner imagery presents us with a possible future that in some ways we want to avoid. In most ways, the way that they depict it, a toxified city, acid rain, and an earth that people want to escape from. Those are the elements of Blade Runner. Everyone is going off world, they say. So when we're looking at science fiction, speculative fiction, we often see the lessons there for us in the present. And we're quite accepting of it, even though it's fantastical stuff, so Mad Max as well. So cinema gives us all sorts of interesting terrain to look at complex and real issues. Avant-garde cinema in particular is known for exploring unsettling possibilities, both formally, so jarring people with edits, odd sound, narrative experiments where things don't unfold in proper plots the way we'd expect from narrative cinema. Avant-garde, of course, is constantly innovating and expanding the field of representation. So when we study avant-garde, we have to have a certain set of tools to understand what's going on, because it's about experimentation, but it can ask the big questions. But of course, it circulates in more limited ways and among more limited groups. Popular cinema is interesting for different reasons, in popular media generally. The main reason for people looking at this issue in communication or in sociology and the different disciplines is that popular culture allows us to analyze ideology, because it's meant to correspond with the most people watching most of the time. It's created to be popular, to be populist. So as producers and writers and people sit down to create something, they think, will this go over in Alabama, or will this be viewed in Seattle, or will this only be popular among a certain group? They want it to correspond to a lot of people, a lot of people's interests and even fears. So as raw material, cinema and other popular media allow us to look at it in terms of a map of possible fears, to locate those fears. And there's a saying that popular culture hides our hopes and fears in plain sight. So often what we're concerned with is right there. And there's a big discussion right now about the amount of crime shows on television and people loving these crime shows and watching someone with a particular talent go through the procedure of solving that crime. Or the medical shows where people can detect illness with some super intuition or something. So it's all around us in popular culture. Right, so where does the trauma element come in? Well, I think a big part of the discussions, particularly south of the border and about environmental politics and global warming, are riddled with disavowal, as in, that this is not happening, global warming isn't happening. That saying, in the original definition of disavowal, I know very well it's happening, but I am going to disavow that knowledge in order to, say, live more happily in a context where we consume a lot. I think Canadians are first or second in terms of our consumption of resources in the world. So it can be hard to balance our own consumption and our own comforts with the knowledge that it has a cost to workers in Bangladesh and to trees in our own country and so on, and our water in terms of the oil sands. And so there's an element of disavowal. So we wanted to look at that a bit. And in terms of disavowal, cinema also became interesting again because it confronts people with something that they might not want to look at. We tend to think of cinemas as the big pleasure palace and you go to see the melodrama or the comedy or what have you. But in fact, cinema has this long history of confronting us with unpleasant imagery and things that might be a little bit jarring and unusual. So there's some really early films, and nature's been a big theme since the beginning of cinema as well. Roosevelt in Africa, which depicts threatening animals in a dangerous landscape for him as a documentary. Nanook of the North, filmed in Canada by the American Flaherty, and also focused on a very dangerous Arctic climate that makes daily life difficult, and not finding any food is a challenge, and falling through the ice, and so on. So some of the most celebrated early films examine nature, or examine the human being in a natural context. The Plow That Broke the Plains, Per Lawrence's masterpiece from 1936, was about the Dust Bowl. And even it has really sort of grim narration. We can have a peek here. And imagery. Thank you.
without streams, with little rain. Once again, the rains held off and the sun baked the earth. This time, no grass held moisture against the winds and the sun. This time, millions of acres of plowed land lay open to the sun.
So, it's about the drought, of course, and the massive human hardships that that caused, but there are also arguments in there about mismanagement of land, and it's really a documentary that engages with the state and with policies, as well as with these human suffering questions. So it's interesting for those reasons that it's so celebrated and was so sort of canonized. And of course, that film anticipates one of the categories that we looked at, which is the activist documentary, because it had a very rhetorical tone to it. It appealed to people and to policymakers to change certain things about how farming and such were working at that period. So the contemporary eco-activist documentary is thriving, and people are consuming these things in major ways on Netflix and so on. And in other ways, they're turning out to the cinema to see them because they are mapping different social issues and different ecological issues around the world that are otherwise really hard to make sense of. So Darwin's nightmare here, this is such a complicated story, but it's essentially the story of locals fishing Lake Victoria and only able to catch this one Nile perch fish, which was introduced by the British in the mid-20th century, and it goes around and eats up all the other fish. And these people are so poor, they can't even consume this fish. They have to sell it to European markets, and they live on fish heads and the remnants that are left behind. And of course, the planes fly away with the fish and fly back with weapons in them. So there's a strange commerce going on in the film where the best things, the best resources in Africa get exported, and what happens in return is that Africa consumes weapons and certain groups are only too happy to supply those. So those pilots who fly the fish away come back with planefuls full of weapons. I have a peek here.
We are the pioneers to start that business. We are one of the big factories in Mwanza right now. We employ around 1,000 people, indirectly 1,000 people. And it's about 10 years now we are in business. This fish was not in Lake Victoria because I was born in this area. I've never seen this fish before. So it was introduced by somebody.
So it's a predator. Nile perch is an exotic species. It doesn't belong to the lake. Now, it was introduced into the lake
40 to 50 years
and,
ago.
Before 1960s, there were plenty of other species in the lake. And when nile perch was introduced, it started eating all the fish away.
So Darwin's nightmare is so interesting because it's about a colonial history, and it's also about ecology in terms of the dependence of these people on the lake to live. And it branches into warfare, ongoing warfare in those countries because of the weapons being supplied. So like so many resources in Africa, anything that it can be monetized can be turned into weapons. And of course, fueling ongoing civil wars and so on. So it confronts us with various dramas about the age of globalization. And you can see too, the Indian people run a lot of the businesses, and so they often do quite well. And local people are of course, the last priority for that sort of transnational business that's going on with the fish. So it confronts us with something unpleasant. So how does this work? So after The Plow That Broke the Plain and before the contemporary films, there were lots of Hollywood films and other popular cinema that mapped these sorts of concerns allegorically, not representing the thing directly, but representing it in a way that it's literalized as an invading insect, or as a sort of formless thing, or as something that jumps between bodies and sort of literalizes the fears of communism, the spread of contagion, and so on. So they're allegorical, things like War of the Worlds, of course, which took on all sorts of other significance throughout the 20th century, first starting as the book and then the radio play by Orson Welles, which had people panicking, and then as a pretty interesting film in the mid-century, and then a really terrible film by Steven Spielberg. Just one of the worst. He can take it. So, one way to think about confronting the real or reality, which these films are doing to us, is to think about Lacan's three-part structure. So a bit of this theory to help us have fun looking at the films. His theory is that there are these three planes that we exist in. The first is the symbolic, then the imaginary, and then the real. Well, actually, it goes imaginary, symbolic, and real. So what does any of this mean? And it's nice that this isn't a university lecture, so you don't have to write anything down. I don't feel so guilty with these slides packed with text. Students would be revolting right now, rebelling. So the imaginary is the internalized image of plenitude, of the ideal whole self, situated around a notion of coherence rather than fragmentation. So people often talk about sort of the imaginary existence in our very early life where we feel as if we're one with our mom and we don't experience any separation. So that's a sort of a literal example of the imaginary. It's about the ego operating in an unmediated way, and it has no real sense of the internal and external world. When we are living in the imaginary. So we can call it the space between the ego and images, which then gets broken down when the baby, when all of us realize that we're separate creatures, we're separate beings. We see each other, we see ourselves in the mirror, is the idea. And the imaginary is then changed. We don't have this same sense of wholeness and plenitude. And part of that threshold that we pass through is passing into the realm of the symbolic, where we start to signify ourselves. We start to learn to speak and to write and to use our gestures and things to communicate. So we know how to get mom and dad to arrive if we want. We know how to do certain things to symbolize our frustration, or I want a blanket, or I'm thirsty, or whatever it might be. That's the realm of the symbolic. So it involves a formation of signifiers and language, which determine us as subjects. So these things help us to know how to be subjects, how to be people in the world, and how to signify ourselves. So he's pretty extreme in his view, Lacan, saying that we take up a position in the world based on signifiers based on this order of the symbolic. We learn how to be through these symbols. And certainly if you think about gender or other major discourses that we take up as humans, we are certainly accepting and mobilizing symbols to be in those positions, or to take up a certain position. And of course now we're in a great time where people are rejecting those particular symbols, say of gender, and people are saying, I have this body, but I'm going to dress this way, or what have you, just as an example. So we operate in the symbolic realm, and you can see the role that media would play in organizing symbols. It's all about symbolizing our world back to us, and that's part of the reason that we like it. And the real is his third category. So these are very psychoanalytic categories. And the real is that which defies representation. It's always beyond the realm of the symbolic or the symbolic's effort to pin it down. It resists representation. It's pre-symbolic and cannot be symbolized. It's the aspect where words fail, we could say. It's the thing we could say signified by a picture, a documentary photograph, but that of course is lost when that photograph is taken. It's always somewhere else. So we can think of it as sort of our attempt to signify reality, but it always is, of course, impossible to conjure that reality. And that's the real. So the real is often seen as something unpleasant, something looming beyond our ability to signify it. And there are lots of analyses of say something like Jaws, which keeps the shark unseen and then sort of outside the frame for so long that we start to think of it as an unseeable force. And of course, for that reason, it takes on all sorts of fearful qualities, which are not just about a big shark, which are about many other things. So we have a fun slide on that coming up as a reward for going through the theory here. So a nice way to think of it is from the contemporary philosopher Alain Badiou, who has this ongoing dialogue with maybe the most famous living philosopher, Slavoj Žižek. So Žižek and Badiou have this dialogue going on. But of course, he puts it actually more clearly here than I put it. Nothing can attest that the real is real. Nothing but the system of fictions which it plays the role of the real. Or put another way, our insatiable desire to integrate the shock of an ecological exterior is only ever manifest in its representation. So sort of the way a fictional tsunami film can help us get into the work of making sense of that trauma, the real is only available through, and then even then, not quite, but it's only possibly glimpsed through the symbols and signs that we arrange, films, literature, and so on. And of course, we can never get at it. That's the difficulty of the real. So we'll have a look at an example to see how this all works. I thought Dead Calm would be an interesting one because it's an ecological horror story about a couple who've lost their child, who take a long yacht trip to try to get over that event, and are visited by a very bad man. And this is the second part, nature as a healer, because they turn to this boat trip in order to confront, or maybe in their case, to escape from a trauma. And there are lots of these films. Babel is a big one where they go to Morocco after the death of a child. Antichrist, the same thing. The child falls from a window and they go to the cabin in the woods to try to overcome this. So, and the list could go on and on. I'm sure some people can think of more of these where people turn to nature to heal themselves. In Dead Calm, Nicole Kidman and Sam Neill take this trip, and there are sort of elements that suggest that they're happy. But as with most films, really, and certainly these films, an invader, some sort of intrusive force has to arrive to present them with a problem. And I think it's Žižek who said that about horror movies. What are horror movies about? They're about the return of the repressed, something coming back. Why does it come back? It wasn't properly buried, he says. So Pet Cemetery and so on. It wasn't properly buried in terms of being mourned and left in the past. It comes back. So many films about the native burial ground. You know, why are they attacking us? Well, you happen to build this house over a native burial ground, and they're not too happy. So we know, or the spirits aren't. We know this story inside out. So what does this young man represent when he arrives? He shatters the peace. Right, so his name is Huey. And in this analysis, so this is sort of testing that three-part structure from Lacan, he helps to confront this couple with the trauma of their past that they're trying to escape, and particularly the wife, Ray, the character, is trying to escape from it rather than sort of coping, or we should say dealing with it, not coping, but facing it in order to surpass it, to survive. So his appearance starts this cat and mouse game on the boat. And there are lots of scenes in which he's depicted childlike and sort of dependent. And it's not incidental. It's part of this story that she is regressing in a way, and no longer a sort of grown up. She hasn't been able to be a mom because of this horrible event. And so she sort of regresses. And what happens on the boat, once the husband is away, is this strange cat and mouse game between the invader, Huey, and the mourning mother, Ray. And they're both infantilized by the depictions that they each face. And they're both the youngest, they're very young actors in this film, in their early 20s. So he is a very dangerous person, and in threatening their lives, forces Ray, Nicole Kidman's character, to become an active adult and to take on the grief that she's been avoiding and to really face that trauma. So it's accomplished on the ocean, on the open ocean, and it's accomplished by this figure who represents the return of the repressed. He represents the horrifying real that she's been trying to escape. But which is nonetheless necessary for her to heal and get better. I believe in Australia there is a doll called the Baby Huey doll. So an Australian scholar pointed this out, that it's a reference to this very real doll, that he is this childish adult who forces them to confront the real. Right. So what's it about? The couple has lost their child. The mother blames herself because she was driving in the car when it happened. The yacht trip is sought as recovery, so it's a classic nature as a healer film. And they're trying to escape this tragic past. But they must face down the horrifying real in order for them to heal, in order to heal themselves. So nature's often turned to in that way, but here it's got this traumatic element with the appearance of Huey. He is the classic return of the repressed in the sort of horror genre that this is part of. And we see it really everywhere. Last year, there was a big film called Wild, based on a memoir of a woman named Cheryl Strayed, who walked this long West Coast trail after the death of her mother and her own divorce. And it's really not going away. I think more of these films are being produced that sort of examine this use of nature as a healer. So let's have a peek at Wild.
You get lonely?
Honestly, I think I'm lonelier in my real life than I am out here. As I miss my friends, of course. But it's not like I really have anybody waiting for me at home.
How about you? Why are you here?
I don't know. I just need to find something in myself, you know? I think the trail is good for that. I mean, look. This has the power to fill you up again if you let it.
My mother used to say something that drove me nuts. There's a sunrise and a sunset every day, and you can choose to be there for it. You can put yourself in the way of beauty.
My kind of woman.
So in that particular case, which we jumped to quite quickly, it's about the lost mother, and of course, Dead Calm's about the lost child. So as the actress there, Reese Witherspoon, goes along her journey in Wild, she gets closer to sort of grappling with the death of her mom, who was quite a young woman when she died, and this is based on a memoir. So right, those are interesting, and those continue to come out. I think there's one with Robert Redford, where they walk the trail. Is it Redford? I think so. Anyways, these healer films continue to appear. So that's interesting. What about the animal films? I think lots is going on in these animal films that's worth considering. And on top of just the thrill of seeing some of these animals. John Berger's point when he wrote this essay a long time ago now was that industrial society has delimited our relationship with animals. That once the revolution happened, industrial revolution happened, and we started to use factory systems to produce our food and so on, our many people's daily lives are no longer connected with animals. We experience them as meat, and we don't live in proximity to them. So this creates this alienation, which is a classic outcome of mass industry becoming a big deal in our lives. We're not connected to things. We're not connected to our products so much, and we're not connected to the sources of our food. And we're certainly not connected, we don't live amongst animals, most of us. So we pay for the privilege to get back in touch with them, and that was what he was arguing. It's pretty simple, but I think it's so smart, because it makes some intuitive sense. We pay for the privilege to be among animals, to go to a zoo. Disney World offers so many animal experiences and so on, highly commodified. And we want some sort of communion with animals. And they might represent a whole range of things, just sort of like walking the trail in Wild. What is the experience of an animal? Is it healing? Is it to feel not alienated in some way? And certainly in the film Grizzly Man by Werner Herzog, it's a documentary showing a real-life bear enthusiast, Timothy Treadwell, who thinks he's an activist in terms of saving bears, but in fact he's visiting the bears every summer and living among them in Kodiak, Alaska, where they're protected. They're living in a huge wildlife refuge, and they're not in danger from hunters or anybody else, not really. But he lives among them as a self-styled savior of these bears. And he's emotionally unstable, and he's a very interesting character. But he's ultimately attacked and killed by a bear, along with his partner, Amy. But his journey is an interesting one, because he has had all sorts of problems in his adult life in California. He's tried to be an actor and failed. He's worked odd jobs and so on, and he's been rejected up into his 40s by women, and for whatever reasons, that's just the kind of problems that he was facing. And among the animals, he feels serene. And so it's interesting to watch how that unfolds in the film. So we can have a little look at Grizzly Man, which is in many ways, it sort of bridges these categories, because it's a healing narrative that's going on. But there's also this big animal element happening.
I too would like to step in here in his defense, not as an ecologist, but as a filmmaker. He captured such glorious improvised moments, the likes of which the studio directors with their union crews can never dream of.
Doing up there? That's where you're sitting?
Huh? Champion. Hi. How are you? You're such a good champion. I love you. I love you. Okay, get up there and guard that tent. Well, I'm here with one of my favorite bears. It's Mr. Chocolate. Hey, Mr. Chocolate. He is the star of many people across the country, children, people, adults, and we're here in the grizzly sanctuary, but I'm wrapping up my work here in the grizzly sanctuary. Why is that? Because I'm on my way to the grizzly maze, where bears do not have human protection, but are under human threat. Bears like Aunt Melissa, bears like Demon, Hatchet, Downy, and Tabitha, and it's time for me to go to protect them. I wish I could bring Mr. Chocolate with me. You'd be great protection there. He's been with me for over a decade, and he's been my good friend, and I really appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Chocolate. I'll see you again next year. Nope. I'll see him again at Expedition, this end of this expedition. I'll be back here to join you again, back with Mr. Chocolate. But first, it's off to the exciting and often dangerous Grizzly Maze.
Now the scene seems to be over, but as a filmmaker, sometimes things fall into your lap, which you couldn't expect, never even dream of.
Hi, Spirit.
There is something like an inexplicable magic of cinema.
Hi, Spirit. Well, I'm here with Mr. Chocolate and Spirit the Fox, and here comes some of her pops. Yay. Here comes some of her pops. Hi. Hi. Hi, Spirit. Hi, Spirit. Hello, baby.
Coming down. What are you doing to that hat? Where's that hat going? Hey, who's stealing that hat? Let me see that hat. Ghost, I want that hat.
Mayor, Ghost is bad.
Ghost, what are you doing with that hat?
Ghost, that hat is a very important hat. Drop it.
So lots has been written about this film and his ability to construct his own world, his own sort of symbolic world, and also maybe a therapeutic emotional world too with his animal friends, and this is Spirit, and Ghosts are the names he's given these foxes, and also I think one is Timmy the champion, and Tim is his own name, and so lots has been made of sort of what sorts of issues he was going through that he would spend 10 or 12 summers living in a tent with no weapons or anything but supplies among these bears in Alaska. So he was creating sort of this alternate world for himself and turning to nature as a healer, but also having this really quite incredible spontaneous relationship with the animals. And that's not what most of us get. Most of us get to see animals in an aquarium or a zoo, or when we are on a farm, we can see the blander farm animals. But if we want to see something unusual the way that he is, we need to pay for that experience or possibly have it by chance. In BC, we're pretty lucky. If you want to see a bear, you probably can. But there's an industry that peddles animal experiences. And so Blackfish is a really devastating documentary which challenges what they call the captivity industry. It particularly takes on SeaWorld and says this relationship with animals is now perverse because we're paying to take our children or whoever to see these animals. And we're training people that that's how that experience should be and is now. So Blackfish has actually had an incredible impact and even impacted visits to the SeaWorld parks in a major way, like 40%. So there's also additional pressure on the Vancouver Aquarium not to let the cetaceans breed in captivity. So it's quite an incredible moment for activists around this issue. The Cove, of course, was this big film about dolphins and the dolphin slaughter in Taiji, Japan. So it also created all sorts of awareness and then changes in policies about the dolphin killing, although it continued to go on once a year in Japan in this one area called the Cove, where they secretly slaughter these dolphins and collect other ones for SeaWorld and aquariums and marine land and so on. Okay, so we'll finish off with some examples from the so-called Revenge of Nature films. And there are all sorts of examples we can think of. They're probably the most widely circulated. We can think back on the ones we've seen. But Long Weekend from Australia is a really classic one because it takes on this theme directly. It shows this really selfish couple who throw their trash out the window and are just indifferent people, the kind of weekend warriors from urban Australia that go out to have this experience in nature. And they're really just not good citizens in the environment. So the ecosystem has revenge awaiting this couple when they get to their faraway outpost in the bush. They get lost for a long time, and then they start to face certain animal problems. And it results in a really incredible sort of climax. So we can have a look at the trailer here, which I think is kind of fun.
Listen to the sound of evil. It is out there, waiting.
I'm sorry for this.
Powerful, deadly, invisible. They came to take a holiday.
Ta-da!
Now, they are running for their lives. Because something is out there. There are secrets. There are mysteries. There are forces beyond imagination. Challenge them, and every living creature, every blade of grass will turn against you. Prepare yourself for the fright of your life.
Christ!
Long Weekend. An experience in terror and suspense.
It's obvious what genre that one is a part of. It is full of the horror conventions and so on. But it has these other elements to it, which include, maybe unsurprisingly at this point, the loss of a child that is in their recent history and the fact that they're not too pleased with one another at the time when they go on this trip. But he shoots his rifle and his other spear gun at all sorts of living things along the way, as if it weren't obvious enough that they were very bad environmental citizens. So Long Weekend is a classic Australian film, and it was remade a few years ago and with American actors with predictably bad results. That's too bad. So the Revenge of Nature film is made very literal in something like Long Weekend, but it's also present in these other films, maybe more nuanced films such as Deliverance, The Hills Have Eyes, where people are victimized, where particularly urban middle class people visiting a natural setting are victimized by the, say, rougher rural people who don't like their presence there. So these films bring in the element of class, social class, to the ecological experience. So people turn to nature for healing, but in these cases also recreation. And in the case of Deliverance, also a challenge. Again, the middle class sort of weekend warrior wants to test himself in a very masculine way against the raging Whitewater River, and the results are tragic. So in the 70s, this was particularly fraught because it was a decade in which people became aware of environmental concerns, and it was the creation of Earth Day in 1972. Eventually people started to be interested in saving the whales, and there was a changing consciousness, and part of that consciousness was this camping, venturing, even RVing activity that arose or that grew, where people wanted to get back to nature. So there were all sorts of other interesting elements about the 1970s as sort of this difficult decade for the United States, including a huge recession and the incredible competition from Germany and Japan in terms of their recovered economies. Everyone started buying Volkswagens and Toyotas, and Americans were pretty scared. So it was an emasculating sort of a decade for American industry. And getting back to nature was a big part of this experience. But these economic concerns run right through these films, including Jaws, which we'll finish off with. But it's important to look at Deliverance because it's such a major film. And even the banjo twang and certain catchphrases trigger people even today. They're so clearly embedded in the popular culture. Deliverance signifies inbreeding. Deliverance is about violence between the rich and the poor, or the hillbilly and the urbanite. So there's a parallel here between facing down the river, which Burt Reynolds and John Voight and the gang want to do to test themselves, also to do it because the river is about to be dammed and destroyed to build a power station. So they know this, and they know that in where they live in the city, they're the reason they're building a power station. They're going to benefit. The hillbilly, so-called hillbilly people, are not. The rural people will not benefit. They're losing their river and their homes. So is it about the revenge of nature, or is it about the revenge of the poor on the middle class? And in the 70s, lots of films examine this economic relationship. And they underestimate the people and they underestimate the river. When things get nasty with the local people, they have a very difficult moral debate about what to do next. So if you know the most famous scene from Deliverance, the local men, mountain men, accost and surround and rape the man there, the shirtless man, Bobby. And the other men have to learn or have to try to find a way to respond to this. Ultimately, it results in the Burt Reynolds character, Lewis, shooting one of the men with an arrow.
You take this man down out of the mountains and turn him over to the sheriff, there's going to be a trial, all right. Trial by jury.
So what?
We killed a man, Drew. Shot him in the back. A mountain man. A cracker. It gives us something to consider.
All right. Consider. We're listening.
Shit, all these people are related. But goddamned if I want to come back up here and stand trial with this man's aunt and his uncle. Maybe his mama and his daddy sitting in the jury box. What do you think, Bobby? How about you, Ed?
I don't know. I really don't know.
Now, you listen, Lewis. I don't know what you got in mind. But if you try to conceal this body, you're setting yourself up for a murder charge. Now, that much law I do know. This ain't one of your fucking games! You killed somebody! There he is!
I see him, Drew. That's right, I killed somebody. But you're wrong if you don't see this as a game.
Lewis!
Are you listening, Ed? Damn it, we can get out of this thing without any questions asked. We get connected up with that body, and the law... This thing's gonna be hanging over us the rest of our lives. We gotta get rid of that guy.
Just how are you gonna do that, Lewis? Where?
Anywhere. Everywhere. Nowhere.
So there's obviously lots at stake, lots going on here, but an interesting element is the devaluation of the hill people, of the poor people. It's simply a problem now for these middle class men who've been testing themselves on the river for their own sort of galvanization of their own masculinity. Now they are in too deep, and they want to continue on with their way of life, which involves, of course, hiding this corpse. So it's about an engagement in nature that becomes a very big human-to-human crisis, where they're staring at each other across this massive class boundary and decide to hide the body, to bury this body. So then they have this repressed, awful secret that they have to deal with. So Deliverance was a major film nominated for Best Picture. It lost to The Godfather, but it has continued to sort of enthrall people with all the questions it asks, and maybe doesn't answer. I think it offers sort of action and adventure and not a lot of big answers. But the 70s are really interesting to look back on in terms of the cinema that really grabbed people's attention. So we'll finish off with Jaws, which is inescapable. So as in Deliverance, Jaws has some major economic themes in that the main problem of the film is to hide any evidence of the shark, to erase it, because the greedy town council wants to continue having a lucrative summer season. So the people in the Amity Island, sort of off Cape Cod, depend on the summer to earn their year's income. And they have a problem in that they need to keep this a secret for economic reasons. And they want to quietly get rid of the shark. It's surprisingly clever in its form, too. It presents both working, middle, and upper-class people in the three main figures, all of which stand in allegorically for the entire class of people. Richard Dreyfuss is the intellectual and playboy who lives on a trust fund and is the oceanographer. He has no economic concerns. He's a rich jerk. And in the novel, he even sleeps with Brody's wife, which Steven Spielberg, you know, that's too much for him. He didn't, so that's erased from the film. But I'm really being hard on the guy tonight. But I love the film and I love his work. Middle class Brody, who's the sheriff and sort of the hero. And then old sea dog Quint, who fought in World War II and represents an old working class mentality about getting the job done. So they spar the upper, middle, and lower class fellows spar constantly. It's what makes it fun, but it's interesting that they have to, make a decision in the film to dispatch Quint. He's the past, Dreyfuss is the future, is one of the arguments in sort of advanced in the film. But what is it really about? Well, yes, it's about a shark attacking a small community, but what's it about in a more major sense? And maybe even beyond class. We'll look at an analysis here from Slavoj Žižek.
In Steven Spielberg's Jaws, a shark starts to attack people on the beach. What does this attack mean? What does the shark stand for? There were different, even mutually exclusive answers to this question. On the one hand, some critics claim that obviously the shark stands for the foreign threat to ordinary Americans. The shark is a metaphor for either natural disaster, storms, or immigrants threatening United States citizens, and so on. On the other hand, it's interesting to note that Fidel Castro, who loves the film, once said that for him it was obvious that Jaws is kind of a leftist, Marxist film, and that the shark is a metaphor for brutal, big capital exploiting ordinary Americans. So, which is the right answer? I claim none of them and at the same time all of them. Ordinary Americans, as ordinary people in all countries, have a multitude of fears. We fear all kinds of things. We fear maybe immigrants or people whom we perceive as lower than ourselves attacking us, robbing us. We fear people raping our children. We fear natural disasters, tornadoes, earthquakes, tsunamis. We fear corrupted politicians. We fear big companies which can basically do with us whatever they want. The function of the shark is to unite all these fears so that we can, in a way, trade all these fears for one fear alone.
Smile, you son of a...
In this way, our experience of reality gets much simpler. Why am I mentioning this? Because isn't it that, for example, the most extreme case of ideology, maybe in the history of humanity, the Nazi, fascist, anti-Semitism, worked precisely in the same...
In the same way.
Sorry, that is... I am not a good editor, and that's evidence of that. In the same way. So he argues that the shark becomes a place to displace our anxieties and fears and so on onto one thing, and then expunge our concerns about other things, so we can unite or literalize, unite and literalize all of our fears onto this one thing, this shark. So we're worried about the economy, think about the shark. You're worried about invasion, think about the shark. And this actually is completely a plagiarized analysis from Frederick Jameson. So Frederick Jameson in 1979 wrote the big essay on Jaws and said exactly this. It allows the public, and over the summer of 1975, people lined up around the block, they saw Jaws again and again. Something was going on psychologically, and it allowed people to worry and to worry about a shark. People were worried about all sorts of other things, but it united those fears. So, economic guilt looms large because even in Jaws, and right in the narrative of Jaws, the town council and the greedy business owners are saying, keep it hush hush, let us earn our living. So there's this, as he calls this, sort of Hollywood Marxism, and apparently Fidel Castro likes the film. But there's something else going on beyond the sort of simplistic cover-up story of the shark. It unites our fears into one thing and lets us worry about that. So we've gone from nature being this healing force to being threatening in a way that it can literalize or it can unite all of our fears in some form, in some animal form in this case, but also it does so in natural disasters, he mentioned. We fear these things as if they're meaningful biblical events or they're intended for us or something. We sort of interpret these events that might not have any meaning in themselves. And there's this weird symbiotic relationship because economically people are cruel to each other in the film and in a range of these, of course, Deliverance. And then, of course, they they have to face down this vengeance that happens. They pay this price for their own selfishness, their selfish interests. So, what do these films do? What do they offer? And is there anything to take away from this sort of analysis? Hopefully there is, but I like this word, which I don't know how to say, but aufarbietung, Adorno's word for working up and working through. It has these two different meanings. And he's talking about coming to terms with a traumatic past. And he opposes it with what he calls turning the page on the past. So he has this nice term, and what he's talking about is trauma, because he's talking about massive persecution and working up and working through are the opposite of turning the page on the past. And in this way, hopefully, in the best possibility, cinema can confront us with some unpleasant realities and involve us in the work of both working up and working through our relationship with the current crises that we're facing globally in terms of the environment. And there's all sorts of tiny examples of that. It takes a range of forms. But in order to work through this trauma and to work through this disavowal that we are engaged in a lot of political debates, people doubting climate science and so on, we need to get worked up. So I like the double meaning of this interesting German term. We need to get worked up in order to work through it. And images can help us, hopefully, that's my argument, can help us do the work or start the work of getting engaged in this sort of grappling with the real of our times, which is ecologically a very challenging time. So these four types, these four maybe genres or forms, all confront us in their different ways, documentary, but also the fiction and fantasy, and hopefully involve us in the work of working up and working through this relationship with the current ongoing trauma of ecological crisis, and hopefully finding new ways to understand our relationship with nature. So, with that, I thank you.
I noticed that conspicuously missing in these categories was comedy and comedic takes on our interaction with history. One example I think of is Tig Notaro's overcoming this triple whammy of like she had C. difficile cancer and her mother died. All in like within a few months, I guess. And at the end of that, she produced this amazing stand-up set that has informed all of her work since then. And they made this documentary about her creating that set. And while you were talking, I was thinking about maybe humor contrasts, like the inevitability, like sort of like the Wile E. Coyote moment where like you run off the cliff and you're not falling until like you finally acknowledge that, you know, you're off the cliff. Do you think that comedy might have a role, and is that maybe one of the roles that it could have, like contrasting its inevitability with something ironic or something like that?
Absolutely, yeah. It's conspicuously absent here, the role of comedy. That's absolutely true. And I think that set you're mentioning became one of the most famous sort of comedy sets ever done because it addressed these tough issues. The closest we came in on the study was looking at WALL-E, the Disney film. And WALL-E was a huge hit, and it sort of had its... But it had a very grim message in a very grim landscape in it, which was a completely destroyed Earth, where one little robot is a trash compactor and goes through his day compacting trash. And there's a sort of Walmart reference in it that it's called By and Large. Everyone has overdone it and destroyed the planet. But there's a comedic relationship that begins between him and, of course, another robot called Eve. And together they get the first life to start living again on the planet. They get this plant to grow. But it the argument from this author was that comedy is used in the way you're suggesting to really overcome or make palatable the very difficult message that's going on in the realities that are faced. Comedy has lots of possibilities as well. By taking things to their extreme, there's a way to, which these films do as well, you know, speculative films, Mad Max and so on, they take something to the extreme so that we can see it sort of clearly. And I think that's very interesting that you mention that. For sure, that's right. Yeah. Absolutely. And Crocodile Dundee, something like that, where it's really a comedy, but it takes place in the outback, which is endlessly threatening. I mean, there's a crocodile attack and all this other stuff that happens. That's a neat one. Yeah.
On the subject of disavowal, it sort of made me think that if you were going to see a movie like The Cove or Blackfish, it implies a certain self-awareness about your place in nature and like the socio-economic structure of, like as you said, commoditizing our interactions with animals. So is it sort of a safe assumption to say that the fictional depiction of like disasters is probably the only way to start a conversation about our environmental impact with someone who is prone to disavowing?
So using a type of film to start that discussion?
Yeah, using a disaster movie to get someone who, or get a demographic that is disavowing environmental disaster to even open up to the conversation of actual environmental disaster.
Definitely, yeah, definitely. And I think the filmmakers have, of the popular films, are having fun with that particular problem and possibility with The Day After Tomorrow, the film where the world freezes very quickly. There's a character that's styled after Dick Cheney, who is endlessly promoting oil and also going to these meetings and saying, oh, global warming, this and that doesn't exist. And the film had this interesting, quite direct depiction of him, which got people talking, people on the right, or people that wouldn't consume an activist documentary, because everyone went to go see Day After Tomorrow. It was this disaster film with big Hollywood people in it. And then they were confronted with something very different. And it also had a hilarious scene, speaking of comedy, where people in the United States migrate south across the Mexican border to save their own lives. And it said, the Mexicans aren't too happy with this stream of immigrants from the U.S. And so in both those ways, it started this discussion among people that might not usually think about these themes and these issues. So absolutely, I mean, that's the fun and definitely the value of popular culture, is that it can confront such a huge group of people and even start that discussion, which might lead in more important directions, or might lead people to pursue some research on one of these topics beyond just the fun of the catastrophe in the movie. Yeah, that's a good question.
So to kind of follow up that kind of question about, you know, disaster movie or apocalypse, you know, Hollywood, this picture of Hollywood, I think like for me, when I was thinking about, you know, those kind of visual narratives about nature, the problem is, I think in many cases, it's actually turn, you know, nature into a kind of spectacle for you to enjoy, for your enjoyment. And also, I think in those kind of narratives, actually, there's nature is not vulnerable, right? Especially when you're thinking about the revenge of nature. A missing part for me is actually the narrative there. There's no vulnerability of the nature, so why do we need to protect them if you really think about it that way? So, like, what's your kind of, you know, comment on that? Because that's, like, for me, I think that's kind of the problematic part about the, you know, narrative in disaster films regarding nature.
Absolutely, and yeah, nature is this menacing force without any of the depiction of the people as vulnerable or well, as themselves. Let's see, long weekend, they're vulnerable, but they're also extremely selfish, and we see this as a sort of moral revenge or something on them. But in a lot of these other films, nature is a menacing force that needs to be tamed and is completely antagonistic to the characters. And in Deliverance, that's the same. The river ends up breaking their bones after that scene we looked at. They end up severely injured. And so absolutely, that's maybe another category, or that could be examined more in the revenge of nature category, that there's a vilification of nature that goes on, where it needs to be controlled and tamed. And that does no good work in terms of reorienting our relationship with nature, because at the moment, nature is profoundly fragile in our actual global context. So there might be a problem there, like you point out.
Thanks, Anil. That was really interesting. Lots of great stuff there. Just quickly, one of the criticisms that's often made of particularly, I would say, activist documentaries or documentaries about ecological collapse is that they leave the audience with a sense of helplessness, a sense that this is happening, it's terrible, it's horrible, I see it, I have a kind of visceral emotional reaction, but that reaction is largely framed in terms of I'm powerless to do anything about this. So the spectacle is a spectacle of devastation that is unstoppable. And you finished your talk with a reference to Adorno. And in this context, I wanted to actually ask you about one of Adorno's contemporaries, and that's Walter Benjamin, who, as I'm sure you know, one of the things that he was most excited about in terms of the power of new aesthetic technology like film was its capacity to give people a sense of their collective power that other forms of art and culture were unable to effectively communicate. Is that something that you observed or that you thought about in terms of an essential task that film can do, different kinds of film activism, fictional film, that perhaps rather than enforcing the spectacle of devastation, rather than sort of reminding us again and again and again, collapse is imminent, that in fact it's the more important task at this point is to give people, people who are aware and concerned and so on about this, a sense of their capacity to actually engage with the problem. A sense in particular of their capacity to engage beyond simply through, you know, individual lifestyle choices, changing light bulbs, et cetera, but a sense of their political power, a sense of their collective potential to engage with the problem. Is that, in fact, one of the most important tasks of cinema in terms of shaping how we engage and think about and act around ecological devastation? And did you find any examples of that in terms of the research that you were doing?
I finished off also trying to be a little bit optimistic too about cinema confronting us with something that might be difficult to process and things we just might not know. So it's the pedagogical as well as confronting in a way that makes us grapple with the unpleasant reality and so on. As far as I know, I think Adorno was very pessimistic about the role of popular culture in targeting citizens or in shaping people to be active citizens. He sort of saw them as pacified. But Walter Benjamin was quite optimistic in most accounts of that of his cinema studies, that he saw cinema as this unique technology that had this dimension that he called the optical unconscious, where it could confront people in different ways. It could change our way of seeing, and not just in terms of what they can do with cameras, but it could change our way of seeing certain issues and even politics. So I'm optimistic, I think, throughout this study that's a possibility for cinema. One major reason is that, in terms of the pessimism that both the questions address, there have been people, including David Suzuki and others for a long time, who have been really communicating with us in Canada about these major crises. But David Suzuki has faced a sort of a pessimism problem and a tuning out problem. And I think they're trying to address that right now in his messaging. But there was sort of a relentless pessimism that was going on that now continues in the film work of Naomi Klein and Avi Lewis, who've been sort of savagely critiqued recently for their documentary about capitalism being incompatible with environmental progress and so on. And I think that they're making some of the same mistakes that David Suzuki has made for a long time, which is that there's an embedded pessimism. And you are confronting people with statistics, scientific reports, these sorts of forms of information that people aren't prepared for, including me. I can't make sense of a lot of those reports. The hidden weapon in cinema is, of course, confronting people on an affective level, an emotional level. And I think that that's its key. One of the arguments about the success of An Inconvenient Truth in 2006 was that it framed the scientific literature in moral terms. And Al Gore himself spoke about that. We took the findings from scientific literature and we put it in moral terms that would appeal to people in the heartland or people that are big fans of going to church. We confronted them emotionally and morally with possibilities, not scientifically with declining population numbers, declining fisheries, declining this and that. So I think that is the potential of cinema, is that it has this incredible technical dimension and this incredible affective dimension, which is missing from, say, political and scientific, a lot of political and most scientific discourse. And I'm biased because I really like movies, so...